Good morning, everybody. We're going to get started. For those of you that don't know, I am Mike Morey, the current president of the West Side Economic Alliance. Why, thank you. If you really knew, with Pam Treese as your executive director, I really don't have to do a whole lot, so it's kind of a nice job to have. First of all, thank you all for coming once again. These breakfasts are an important part of the West Side Economic Alliance program. We appreciate it. Hopefully you all are members. If you are not members, please think about it. Please ask anyone that is a member. Please pick up some information on the way out. We would love to have you join. It's a, the backbone of our whole group is the membership, so please, please join. We're pleased today to have two great guests, Congresswoman Bonamici and a late arrival, Congressman Schrader. He is, quote, stuck in traffic. So hopefully that can be one of the topics we discuss today, problems that we might all have every morning. So to keep it moving, I'm just going to quickly introduce Pam Treese, our executive director. And once again, thank you all for coming. Thanks, Legacy, for sponsoring. I myself have to run to a different breakfast, so thank you all. Pam?
Thank you, Mike. As he mentioned, Congressman Schrader is stuck in traffic. I got a text message from them. But I'm not sure that this might not be a payback. For those of you that were here last year, you may remember that Congresswoman Bonamici had to leave early and left Kurt on the stage by himself for a while. So you might ask him that question when he arrives. So my name is Pam Treese, and I'm the executive director of West Side Economic Alliance. I want to thank you all for being here this morning. It's great to see so many faces here. I especially want to thank Legacy Health for being our presenting sponsor for this event, but also for being our breakfast series sponsor. WEA has had the great fortune to have an outstanding relationship with Legacy Health. They participate in all aspects of what we do, what we try to accomplish, and they are very positive. It's a great pleasure to work with Gina Cole on the Government Relations Committee. I work with Paseth on all sorts of different issues when it comes to marketing, and there's never a time that I make a phone call and they don't answer immediately. So I really want to thank you for your sponsorship and thank you for the work that you guys do with our organization. So thank you. So I mentioned our partnership with Legacy Health, and I'd like to take a moment now and introduce you to a key player at Legacy Health, Dr. Mike Newcomb. Dr. Newcomb has been with us previously when we've had breakfast for him, so I've had the honor of introducing him previously. He is the Chief Operating Officer at Legacy Health. He oversees operations at 7 hospitals and has oversight responsibilities for the Legacy Medical Group, security, facility maintenance, laboratory operations, and biomedical maintenance. That seems like it might be an important one. Dr. Newcomb served in the United States Army for 22 years in a variety of clinical and leadership roles, culminating in the position of Principal Director for Clinical and Program Policy, Office of the Assistant Secretary of Defense for Health Affairs in Washington, D.C., and overseeing the development of all clinical and healthcare-related policy for the Defense Health Program. He also served as the commander, or CEO, of Martin Army Hospital in Fort Benning, Georgia, commander of the 212th Mobile Army Surgical Hospital, or MASH, in Zagreb, Croatia, and as the director of health services in the Office of the Army Surgeon General. So I'm going to talk a little bit more, but most importantly, thank you for the service that you provide to that you provided to our country. That's much appreciated. He also enjoys sailing and opera. So talk about a man of many, many talents and a very eclectic interest. So please come up and give us a few words about Legacy Health.
So it is really a pleasure to have the opportunity to come back here to the West Side Economic Alliance and to greet you all yet again. The mission I was given today, that's an Army term, mission, The mission I was given today was to give you an update on the Unity Center for Behavioral Health in 3 to 5 minutes. Now, usually when I get started on the Unity Center, it's a minimum of 20 to 30 minutes. So this is really quite a challenge for me. For those of you who may not be familiar with the Unity Center, it is a mental health facility to treat people with, obviously, with mental health issues and substance abuse disorders that we're building right now as we speak in the former Holiday Park Hospital, which is in Portland, right near the convention center. And when it's finished, and it's almost done, I'll give you more on that in a second, it will house a 102-bed inpatient mental health facility. 22 of those beds will be for child and adolescent, and 80 beds for adults. It will also have a dedicated psychiatric emergency service that will take care of people who are going through an acute crisis, be it, again, mental health crisis or a substance abuse disorder, and they're very often combined. It also has a couple other very unique legs to the four-legged stool that is Unity Center. It also is going to incorporate literally dozens and dozens of community-based organizations that serve people on an outpatient basis, everything from Central City Concern to Trillium to LifeWorks Northwest. I could go on and on and on, and it's one of the things that we do have a good number of in this metropolitan area are a lot of outpatient services, but one of the problems with them is they have not been able to have a single place to really coordinate their services. And that is going to be the Unity Center, and they've been very, very active in the development of this program. And then the fourth leg of the stool is a group that's really coming into the fore now, and it's peer support services. And these are people who have been through a crisis themselves, have gotten through it, and they have received additional training so that they can help people who are now going through a crisis on their own. And it's more than just a support group. These are truly trained professionals to help people get through that acute phase. And they're going to be centered in Unity Center and will be paired with patients, with appropriate patients, to follow them not only while they're in the facility, but then as they transition to the outside. Now, that's, you know, there are inpatient mental health facilities around the country. There are several psychiatric emergency rooms. Certainly a lot of outpatient services. Like I said, peer support services are coming into their own. But nobody in the country has put together a program like this one. And the reason that this is truly unique is it is a collaboration. And people usually think of, well, it's four health systems that are collaborating. Legacy, OHSU, Adventist, and Kaiser have all come together to put this program into place. And that in and of itself is a little bit unique when you think that we're four pretty ardent competitors in many, many ways, but for this reason and for this purpose, we've all come together because we realize this is a terrible need in our community that really needs to be addressed. But it goes way beyond just the four organizations, because nowhere has there ever been a program like this that's been supported by four competing organizations, three counties, and I really thank the counties, Washington County, Multnomah County, Clackamas County, who have all come together to participate in this, both in a financial way, a very significant financial way, but also to lend a lot of support. The county sheriff's offices have been very supportive of this. Portland Police Bureau has been extremely supportive of this, and there's a good reason for that. Quite honestly, someone with a mental health problem that's encountered out in the community, the last place that they need to be and the worst place they need to be is in the back of a police vehicle, much less in a jail. They need to be able to go somewhere where they're going to get the care that they need. The second worst place that they can be is in a regular emergency room. In all of our emergency rooms, and every hospital throughout Washington, frankly, throughout the country, is suffering from this. A patient comes in with an acute mental health problem. Emergency rooms are great for taking care of people who have physical problems. It could be a traumatic problem or a physical disease problem, but mental health is not their forte. It's really a specialized area. It needs psychiatrists, it needs mental health nurses, it needs behavioral health therapists, it needs social workers, all put together, and that's what we're doing at Unity. It's going to have all of those elements 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, all in one location. And no one has put together a program like this anywhere else in the country, and we're very, very proud of that. So, Thank you. So we look forward to hopefully seeing some of you there during our grand opening, and there will be many invitations put out once we figure out when exactly that's going to be. It'll be somewhere very early in January. And again, I thank you all for allowing us to sponsor this program this morning. So it is my honor to introduce our main event this morning. And I'm going to start with Congresswoman Suzanne Bonamici, who I think everybody knows. And she is here, as we were told this morning, until the election's over, and then is back to D.C. because I'm confident, as I think many of us are, that that's where she's headed, right back there again to fight the good fight. Congresswoman Bonamici represents the 1st Congressional District of Oregon, which comprises the northwest portion of the state. Strengthening public education is one of her top priorities and has been for a long time, even before she went to Congress, and is one of the reasons she got involved in public service. As a member of the House Committee on Education and Workforce, she's dedicated to giving educators and students the resources they need to succeed. She also serves as a member of the Committee on Science, Space, and Technology, and is the top Democratic member of the Subcommittee on Environment. Congresswoman Bonamici worked her way through college at Eugene, first at Lane Community College and then at the University of Oregon, where she got her bachelor's degree and then subsequently her law degree. She and her husband, Michael, have been married for more than 30 years and have two grown children. And in absentia, I know he's going to come racing through the door in a minute, I'm also going to introduce Congressman Kurt Schrader, and since he's not here, I can say whatever I want about him. However, I'll stick to the script. He is currently serving his fourth term in the United States House of Representatives. He represents Oregon's 5th Congressional District, which includes all of Marion, Polk, Lincoln, and Tillamook counties, as well as the bulk of Clackamas and a portion of Multnomah and Benton counties. It tires me out just to read all of that. Congressman Schrader currently serves as a member of the exclusive House Committee on Energy and Commerce. Prior to joining ENC, he served in the House Committee on Agriculture, where he also was on the Farm Bill Conference Committee that successfully passed a very important 5-year farm bill. The House Committee on Small Business and the House Budget Committee. In the 114th Congress, he'll serve on the Energy and Commerce Subcommittee on Health and the Subcommittee on Environment and Economy. Congressman Schrader is the co-chair for administration for the Blue Dog Coalition and served as co-chair of the No Labels Problem Solvers Caucus from 2013 to 2015. And he is also a member of the New Democrat Coalition. Before being elected to Congress, he was a farmer and a veterinarian for more than 30 years. He established and managed the Clackamas County Veterinary Clinic in Oregon City and operated his farm where he grew and sold organic fruit and vegetables. He attended Cornell University where he received his BA in government, and he received his veterinary degree from the University of Illinois in 1977. So it is with great pleasure that I welcome Congresswoman Suzanne Bonamici to the stage.
Thank you very much.
Hear me. Oh, I think I was supposed to climb up into this big chair. Maybe I won't. So thank you so much, Dr. Newcomb. Thank you to Legacy for hosting and the Westside Economic Alliance. It's great to be back. I know Kurt will be here soon. But Dr. Newcomb, thank you very much for talking about the Unity Center and giving that update. Even though the Unity Center itself is in our colleague Earl Blumenauer's district, we are all watching very closely the progress of that unique Oregon collaboration because it can serve as a model. It's desperately needed. I did a ride along with the Washington County Sheriff. We took 2 trips to the emergency room just in a short period of time when they really needed something like the Unity Center. So thank you for that work. So it's great to be back at the Westside Economic Alliance, and I've been asked to give an update on the work in Washington, D.C., and I know Kurt is planning to talk about healthcare issues, which are in primarily in the committee on which he serves, Energy and Commerce. So I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the things that we have been working on and have been able to accomplish, and I know you'll have questions afterward. One warning, though, is that we're not very good at predicting what's going to happen on November 8th, so everybody has their own ideas about that. So I do serve on the Education and Workforce Committee, and as you heard in the introduction, education is really a passion of mine. I got involved, Frank Angelo shaking his head back there, because our kids went to school together back in the elementary school days. My youngest child was born the year Measure 5 passed, and I went through the school advocacy and standing on the Capitol steps waving Save Our School signs and doing a lot of volunteer work. And then when I served in the Oregon Legislature, working on education policy, I really see public education as a key to so many things, whether it be growing our economy, the quality of life in our communities, how we address the challenging problems that are before us for our future. So one of the reasons I went to Congress was because federal education policy was really affecting what was happening in our states, in our counties, and in our local schools. So I got on the Education and Workforce Committee. I served my first year on the Budget Committee as well as the Science Committee, and then earned a place on the Education Committee. And I'm happy to report that we did have success in getting rid of, or I like to say, leaving behind, No Child Left Behind. And that is a law that was well-intentioned. It started out as the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, to bring equity to more students in public schools across the country. And that's what funds, for example, Title I dollars that help schools that have high populations of low-income students. But the changes that we made were all for the good. We give more decision-making back to our state and local education leaders where it belongs. No more one-size-fits-all from Washington, D.C. education decisions. Fewer better assessments. I was proud of that piece I got in there. Yes, we need to assess students, but we need better quality assessments and not so many of them. And then finally, the important part is more focus on well-rounded education. We know in Oregon, we have a pretty embarrassing dropout rate, and I truly believe that these changes that we made in the federal policy, as well as the work that's being done to bring back things like career and technical education, are really going to help not only engage more students, but also make sure that our education system is preparing students for whatever path they take in life. And I wanted to mention, in addition to, it's called the Every Student Succeeds Act, and I got to stand with President Obama when he signed it into law. I had been on the conference committee, and I was really proud of that work. We did that recently. The House passed the Career and Technical Education bill. It's called the Perkins Act, after former Congressman Perkins. And that's the federal investment in CTE programs. And hi, Kurt. And I know that Oregon has been working on gradually bringing back those classes that we used to call them shop classes, but the career and technical education, hands-on learning, that's so important. I tell you, some of these I visit. I was just out at Aloha High School in Beaverton where they have a great auto tech class. There's a big piece of equipment there that they got using the federal dollars. We know that school districts don't have extra money lying around to buy things like 3D printers or auto tech equipment and things like that that are so important for these programs. So the House passed it. There were only five no votes, so broad bipartisan support. I hope that can get through the Senate. I hope by the end of the year, as a U of O graduate, I don't really like the term lame duck, if you get what I mean. So in that time between when we come back and the end of the year, I don't see any reason why the Senate wouldn't get that through. Another effort in the education front that I've been working on is STEM to STEAM, integrating arts and design into STEM learning for more creativity and innovation. That's been a lot of fun. I have 87 bipartisan members in the caucus now because we understand when we talk with business leaders, they want people who are problem solvers and who can communicate and who are creative. And that all comes from educating both halves of the brain. And I'm happy to report that there are 8 model STEAM schools in this country, and 2 of them are right here in Northwest Oregon. Quatama Elementary in Hillsboro and Highland Park Middle School in Beaverton are doing great things, engaging students and teaching them how to be creative problem solvers. Another thing that happened in the Education and Workforce Committee that I'm proud of is that we passed the Older Americans Act. That isn't just a law that affects older Americans or our seniors. It affects families who are helping to take care of them and the families who are struggling with taking care of their parents and trying to save for college. So the Older Americans Act also signed into law funds important programs like Meals on Wheels, senior centers, community centers, programs that help seniors stay in their homes and live their lives with dignity. So I was proud of that work as well. Just a couple of other things. Kurt and I both have coastal areas in our districts, and I was just out on the coast over the weekend. We're all concerned about the resilience issues and how we prepare for earthquake and tsunami. So we've been able to get some more funding for Shake Alert, which is a great earthquake warning system. One of the first bills that passed in this Congress, and Kurt supported it as well, as my Tsunami Education Research and Warning Act to help our local communities prepare for tsunami. Passed the House, the Senate made a few changes. I'm hoping to get that back across the finish line as well. And then I mentioned, Kurt, that you're gonna talk a lot about healthcare issues, but I did wanna mention transportation because both of, well, that was my understanding. You can change that if you want. Both of us are big supporters of that infrastructure investment that we need that's so important for our economy, the FAST Act, which was the five-year transportation bill that we passed. I have Yamhill County in my district, so I got in an amendment that makes the Newburgh-Dundee bypass a high-priority corridor, so anybody going down there for wine country knows how important that bypass is. We just got some great news for Tiger that a grant came through yesterday. Great grant came through for Metro for the South Corridor, Southwest Corridor. So we're working on those transportation infrastructure investments that are so important. I know we're already talking about how we reauthorize that. You know, 5 years seemed like a long time at the time, but that's going to go by quickly. And I know I certainly support a robust investment in our roads, bridges, electric grid, and all the infrastructure. So I'm going to let Kurt take over now and then look forward to answering your questions. So thank you very much.
Kurt, before you start, okay. Congressman Schrader, I'm over here. I just wanted to thank you very much for being here, and I did want to tell you that in my earlier remarks, I mentioned that you covered for Congresswoman Bonamici right. for a long time at the last forum that you attended, so no problem being a little late.
Well, I appreciate that. We definitely need the FAST Act implemented, I can tell you that. Getting here was more than difficult. I got a nice snooze on the way over here early morning. But yes, that's one of the major accomplishments of this last Congress. And I think as I alluded to when we chatted back in September of, I think last year, the Congress has gotten a lot done. You don't know that. It's not fashionable in the media to talk about it. Suzanne's work in the education workforce area is pretty amazing. Who'd have thought we'd be able to rewrite No Child Left Behind? You know, with the partisanship that's out there, and her committee did just that. The Carl Perkins stuff is out now and available for hopefully moving down the finish line. We'll see. I mean, we've done some pretty incredible things. So when it all looks like doom and gloom, you're watching this horrible presidential race, good news, bad news is Congress is there to save you. So be very worried. I don't know, Suzanne, did you talk a little bit about the lame duck other than the reference? We won't go there, but it could be very important coming up here. There's some unfinished business, the Perkins reauthorization, WERDA, you know, the Water Resources Development Act for a lot of your communities. It's a main source of economic opportunity, compliance, and frankly, jobs for a lot of folks out there. Help again the whole trend, I think, with the transportation bill this last year, and hopefully word of this year is that we're providing jobs for working men and women right now, and also building our economic competitiveness going forward. So both Suzanne and I are very interested in your priorities, obviously, for implementation of all those areas. Trade's another big area. We'll see what happens. I think our only opportunity to pass that, if you're so inclined, is going to be in this lame duck session. Both presidential candidates have taken a fairly strong stand against it, would appear. The current president is still promoting it, obviously, and It's highly contentious, as both Suzanne and I know, within the existing Congress. So stay tuned on that. I think that'll be getting a lot of attention. And then, frankly, the budget. I mean, you guys still have priorities. We just did a CR till, you know, middle, was it December 16th or something like that? Yeah, it's the short term. So we have, we're going to have a budget of sorts, whether it's a bunch of little appropriations bills for the 12 appropriation areas with some continuing resolution remains to be seen. The Republican leadership, both in the Senate and the House, are working on that as we speak. So if there's things you're particularly interested in that you haven't seen in the CR, that you're wanting to see if we can get in, you know, there are no more earmarks, but there are, as Suzanne alluded to, many grant opportunities, and your community has competed very, very successfully in that arena, and I would anticipate being able to do so going forward. I'll talk just briefly about health. We're on the Energy and Commerce Committee, which, believe it or not, handles health care for, it sounds like that would be logical in this day and age for Congress. And good news, I think, despite what you're hearing in some of the by some of the candidates running for congressional office these days, you know, the repeal thing is long gone. No one's pursuing that really anymore. We have a token vote on that, you know, every 6 months in our committee, but leadership tells them they have to do that. But the chairman's not that interested in it, and certainly even the subcommittee chairman's not into that particular mode of thinking. And we've actually had some interesting, we've had at least two different hearings in the subcommittee on things to fix, you know, the ACA, where there may or may not be things that could advantage both providers and insurance companies to deal with the fact that we have a very unbalanced individual market at this point in time. And what I'd like to try and remind people on the stump, and you all know it here, is that at least in our state, it's been pretty successful. I mean, the work that the CCOs have done is pretty incredible, you know, driving up primary care, driving down hospital readmission rates for a whole variety of things. We're actually seeing great success. It's starting to be mimicked in the commercial market, but we're at an inflection point. You know, frankly, here in this state, and I think nationally, with how does the ACA go forward? You know, 95% of the healthcare market is in really, really good shape. It's that 5% individual market that's the problem. You know, the young immortals are still feeling pretty immortal these days and decided not to sign up. And, you know, penalties are kicking in, finally. I actually think with a lot of conversation with healthcare providers, some in this room, with Laura Kelly, that, you know, Oregon has gotten to a point where our insurance rates are probably in a much more sustainable arena than what they've been prior to this. But I'm still, personally, very worried about that individual market and how we proceed. We want to make sure it's robust. We want to make sure insurance providers feel that they can compete in this arena and we can take care of those people. So look forward to your ideas in that regard. We're trying to get different work groups together to talk about how best to make sure that one last aspect of the healthcare bill works. But I've got Republican colleagues now very engaged for a change. We've had a lot of fun, I think, in trying to figure out where do we go forward here. And I think there's an opportunity in this next election cycle after Clinton wins. You know, frankly, 2018 is going to be a pretty tough cycle for a lot of members of our party. I think there's going to be some reckoning on the other side of the aisle also about what heck happened this go round. But hopefully it'll provide an opportunity for moving forward in a whole variety of different areas. The Republican majority in the House anyway is going to have to show some sort of results. You know, if Paul Ryan wants to be president someday when he grows up, he's going to have to show that he can actually deliver at the end of the day. So that therein provides some opportunities for all of us. And I think he's a reasonable guy, but given the politics of his party and to some extent our party, where the extremes seem to dominate, it's going to require a lot of your effort to keep us on the straight and narrow and actually get stuff done for the average individual that really wants to succeed in our great country and state. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I am going to ask one question, and then we're going to open to the floor for questions. You just talked about partisan rhetoric, and it seems to predominate these days. So
how are you working to build relationships across the aisle? And why don't we start with Congresswoman Bonamici?
Thank you, Pam. And Kurt was right that we actually do get things done, but you don't see a lot of that. You know, with all due respect to the very important media, they're not going to do a story about, you know, members of Congress are getting along today. So the commitment that I took with me when I went to Congress, you know, I served in the majority when I was in Salem. I've always been in the minority in Congress, but I know my constituents didn't elect me to only get things done when I'm in the majority. That's not how it works. Once we get there, we represent everybody, and we're committed to getting things done. So I took with me to Congress the same attitude that I had in Salem, but you find partners with people. I was also taken aback at first joining Congress about how heated and partisan some of the speeches were on the floor of the U.S. House. I made a commitment to not do that. I talk about policy. I don't talk about people or parties. And I try to find common ground. And it starts with the understanding that, and I think Kurt will agree with this, that everybody who's there basically wants the same thing. They want good jobs. They want good schools. They want a strong economy. They want the country to be secure. They want a clean planet. They just have different ideas about how to get there, and importantly, different ideas about the role of government in each of those areas. But once you start with the understanding that everybody there wants the same thing, and you find common ground, you find something to agree with on somebody, that even if we don't agree on everything, we can certainly partner on things. I'm working with Jim Bridenstine, representative from Oklahoma, very conservative representative, on a bill to improve weather forecasting, for example. And it started out where he wanted to take a lot of money out of climate research and put it into the Weather Service. And I explained that that probably wasn't going to get through both chambers and be signed into law. So let's sit down and find a better way to do that. And we did. And we have a good bill that I put my name on and encourage my colleagues to support. So you find something in common with people. And then finally, I just make friends with everybody. And even if I don't end up working with somebody, I just went on a trip. I was honored to be invited to a funeral for Shimon Peres in Israel, and was honored to go on that trip. And a couple of my Republican colleagues were sitting with me, and they said, "You're always over on our side of the floor talking to people, and you don't say mean things about us." So it's basically, you know, somebody said, "Do you use your lawyer skills a lot?" No, I use my mom skills a lot. You be nice to people. You respect them. Even it's a respectful disagreement, and then you can find something where you agree. So that's my personal approach, is that finding something in common with people and then working together with them. Thank you.
Yeah, I'd agree. I think Suzanne said it very, very well. We actually like each other in the United States Congress on both sides of the aisle. We know each other to varying degrees. We know each other's families, worry about each other, and worry about each other's election prospects back home, regardless of what side of the aisle you're from. So it's not nearly as bad as the media would have you imagine, by any stretch of the imagination. One of the biggest problems we have is our leaderships. You know, unfortunately, they, instead of good leadership, which brings you together to solve problems, they tear us apart to be partisan. The bill drafts we get from our respective partisan committees, we have partisan committee staff, unlike here in Oregon. As a result, I get this extreme left-wing view of a bill that's really something pretty simple and many times very reasonable. Similarly, their staff puts out this right-wing manifesto that is also not really representative of what the bill is. So it's incumbent upon experienced legislators like Suzanne, hopefully myself and others, to read between the lines, get good information, make good value-based judgments. I'm a blue dog. There aren't many of us in the United States Congress. This is a fairly moderate to conservative business Democrat group. Used to be 54 of us a few election cycles ago, and because of our hubris and some misinformation on the other side of the aisle, we're down to 15 members. And these are the folks that come from very tough districts. You know, we have two of those in our state, mine and Peter DeFazio's, actually. Peter makes it look easy. I always make it look a lot more difficult than it probably needs to be. But there are very few districts that are competitive. And as a result, to Suzanne's point, people are not used to listening to a different point of view. You know, they're, out of the 435 districts out there, 400 are rock solid safe for a Democrat or Republican. So they're in an echo chamber to some degree, unless they're like Suzanne, they reach across the aisle and are trying to say, wow, you know, where are you from? What are you about? So it's difficult. Blue dogs, we come from those districts where I have to listen to everybody all the time. And our mantra is to be bipartisan. We routinely will be voting against our own leadership's stridency when we see an opportunity to work for the other side. The name of the game is to get to yes, not get to no. And if it's a reasonable bill, we'll try and do there. So we build those relationships with the Republican equivalent, which is called the Tuesday Group. So hopefully this election cycle, both the Tuesday Group and the Blue Dogs will grow in numbers, and there'll be more increased opportunity for bipartisanship. I'm also a founder of what we call the No Labels Problem Solvers Caucus. And this is a movement I'd urge each and every businessman or woman in this room to get engaged in. It's a national grassroots movement to improve civility and get things done in the United States Congress. You can be a screaming liberal or a right-wing zealot, or you could be just a scrunchy, drab moderate, you know, like Kurt Schrader in the middle, and still get things done. That's the requirement. There's 70 members, about 35 Democrats, 35 Republicans. I think it's the genesis of a better discussion when you sit down at the breakfast table or lunch table and break bread together and realize we don't have horns and pitchforks. We're just regular people, both sides of the aisle.
Thank you. Questions from the audience? All right.
I saw Mayor Willie.
Mayor Willie, I'm coming to you with the microphone.
Well, good morning. It's always good to hear from you, too. And we certainly think you're representative of Oregon, and we appreciate your perspective and certainly ideas and work. From this meeting, I'm going to meet with about 50 high school students. And I met with a group last week as well. And my question to them was, did you watch the debate? And if you did, what was your takeaways? And what would you have preferred to heard? So for the group that I'm meeting with at 10 o'clock this morning, what would you like me to tell them or solicit from them for their perspective of our political election process?
That was a great question, Mayor. I always enjoy talking with high school students. It really gives you perspective on, you know, hope for the future. I actually did not watch the debate right away. My blood pressure. I had an event that evening with the Oregon Historical Society, which was wonderful and positive. But I'm deeply disappointed. I mean, as an elected official, I am very deeply disappointed at the tone and tenor of what has happened at the presidential level. And in fact, that evening I was listening to a couple of friends debate whether they have young children who are interested in politics. They didn't want their kids to watch the debate because of the language and the rhetoric and the downright meanness of it. So I think I would certainly want to convey to the students that that's not reflective. What's happening currently at the presidential level is not reflective of a typical political race. And every once in a while, yes, there are, you know, attack ads or pointing out contrasts with a candidate. But this one has become so personal and so nasty that it does not reflect on our, you know, what we stand for as a country, what we want in our leadership at the top of the ticket. I mean, it's pretty embarrassing. And I just, November 8th can't come soon enough. I think you all agree with that. Just because it has really, really turned into something that I never thought I would see in a presidential debate. And I look back at when I started voting a long time ago, and I look back at all the presidential elections, and I have never seen anything that has been so nasty. So I'd be really interested to hear what the high school students have to say about it. And I assume most of them high school probably watched it, but I know younger kids. So I wouldn't want my kids to see it when they were young. So it's disappointing. I don't think it's typical. I hope it never happens again, and I can't wait for it to be over.
No, I'd agree with Suzanne. It's not reflective of what you do. It's certainly not how you act in Salem. It's not how you act in Congress. Unfortunately, the media has made it into a clown reality TV show. And I blame the moderators. They do a horrible job of focusing these candidates on issues that we need to know about, public issues, not private issues, that I want to judge my prospective presidential nominee on. I am shocked, or well, not so shocked. I'm extremely disappointed that they just don't shut the bloody mic off. At the beginning of the debate, you say, Madam Secretary, Mr. Trump, I'm going to shut your mic off if you don't answer the question or you go over time. End of discussion. And by the way, if you get into personal stuff, I'll shut you off and I'll give extra time to the other candidate.
You know, Kurt Schrader for moderator.
And I'd encourage the students not to watch the debates. You're not going to get nothing out of those. They're a waste of time. You tell the students that this congressman thinks they're a total waste of time. And instead, go to a bunch of credible news sources, not the blogs, and look at the different opinions from Wall Street Journal, New York Times, pick your source, Oregonian Statesman Journal, Eugene Register Garden, and form your opinion. You know, the Portland Tribune, the Newport News Times, form your opinion based on your, hopefully, critical thinking that you're learning finally in these schools. Our schools, I think, are doing a much better job than they get credit for, and teaching critical thinking. And use your head and figure out where is the truth, if you will, in this deal. And if you have a favorite news source you like to listen to all the time, don't. Listen to the other news source that you detest so that you have a balanced view when you get a chance to, you know, vote when you're 18 and make that statement. And the last comment I'll make real quick, just so it's crystal clear for y'all, the United States Congress, that behavior never happens. Might have, 100 years ago, but we have rules of engagement. We never get to talk. If Suzanne and I are discussing a bill and she's on one side of it and I'm on the other, I don't get to address her directly. I may be able to look at her, but when I'm talking to the chair, the person at the top of the dais. All my discussion goes through the chair. And that's on purpose so that it doesn't get so personal. Every once in a while, a member forgets. But we've been close to having a member take their words down. That's an arcane reference to if you impugn the motives or the personality of the person that's making that you're discussing things with, your words can be taken down. You can be censured from the floor of the House. So we don't have that problem that you're seeing on reality TV / presidential debates for this year. And God willing, we'll never have that problem.
Thank you. We have a question from Forest Grove, Councilwoman Elena Ewing.
Thank you so much.
Nice to see you.
Thank you, Suzanne. Thank you for coming today. It's really important as a community that we hear from Washington, especially in light of everything that we're experiencing. But I want to talk about housing affordability. I'm also with Willamette West Habitat for Humanity. And this is a problem that's facing the entire nation. But we're feeling it really a crunch here in Washington County. Can you address what things are on the docket coming forward on affordable housing, and particularly affordable home ownership, which is that permanent step out of poverty?
Well, this is an area I'm not as hopeful about as I would like to be, although I will say one of the first major bills we passed out of the House this year was an affordable housing initiative. Unfortunately, there was not a lot more money put into it, but there was an attempt to make sure that the statutory language regarding affordable housing was cleaned up and focused to those that theoretically need it most. Unfortunately, that's becoming a wider population. We see that certainly in the metro area. I was just in Salem, another big chunk of my district's down there. They're feeling the same homeless stuff. The coast, both Suzanne and I, there's a significant homeless population there. The problem we're having is that the HUD budget, Housing Urban Development budget, is one of the toughest to get through Congress. It's very controversial. Section 8 housing is not the normal bipartisan effort that it has been. That may be changing, hopefully, as a result of this election. Hopefully, there's a more balanced representation, at least in the House of Representatives. And I'm sure that it's not just in Oregon we're having this issue. This is a nationwide issue. You talk to home builders and realtors. I was talking with a friend of mine yesterday. It's supposed to be 1 million-plus homes built every year in the United States, and during the recession was like 300,000, maybe 400,000, for obvious reasons, apparently. But to catch up after 3, 4, 5 years of that level, to get back up to the growth rate, just the birth rate, basically in people in homes, it's going to take probably 6, 7 years. So we're not going to, I'm a big one on free market. Let's build our way through some of this, but it's clear to me we're not going to build our way entirely through that. We're going to need some more VASH vouchers for veterans and make sure there's more Section 8 housing that's part of any mix of housing development that's going on here. And thank you for the work you do. Habitat for Humanity draws a nice, popular bead on what the problem is and one of the great ways to solve it.
And I just want to add to that, this is an issue, as Kurt said, that doesn't just come up in urban areas. People have this sometimes misconception that housing challenges and homelessness are just urban issues, and it's not the case at all. It's across Oregon, sadly, and too often across the country. So there are a couple pieces, and Kurt mentioned the legislation that sort of streamlines and clarifies some of the affordable housing federal legislation, but there's also another big piece. I was just over at the Abigail down in Northwest Portland the other day, touring there. I was there for the groundbreaking and then just got to go tour the apartments, and there's some market rate in there, but there's also some affordable apartments, Orchard in Hillsborough and Barcelona and Beaverton. I mean, there's just not enough of these housing opportunities, and the one issue that keeps coming up at each one of those is tax credit. So as we're going forward looking at tax reform, and Senator Wyden, I know, is a leader on this, certainly on the Senate side, is making sure that when we're talking about tax reform, that we understand that those housing, the tax credits for affordable housing are going to be a very, very important part of that. And Kurt mentioned the VASH vouchers and other ways to help, for example, veterans. Astoria, for example, has a real challenge with Coast Guard housing. There's just a lot of different pieces that we need to address, but one of the biggest ways we can do that is make sure those tax credits are there, preserved, and expanded so that those projects can be built and we can have more affordable housing available.
Thank you. Another question from the audience? I'll ask a question then. You talked about your support of the FAST Act, and you talked about your difficulty getting here this morning. Can you take that a step further and talk to us about any ideas for additional federal dollars when it comes to solving our transportation issues? For example, an increase in the national gas tax.
Oh, that's a great question. And
thank you, with just a month to go for the election, sorry.
Congressman Blumenauer has been going around the country talking about this, and I like to say that the federal gas tax hasn't been increased for years, in large part because so many of our colleagues have signed a "I will never under any circumstances raise your taxes" pledge, and they don't want to go back home and say, especially without earmarks, "I raised your taxes," and I can't really show you a road in your district that is going to benefit from that. So it is a challenge, but the increasing the federal gas tax has broad bipartisan support everywhere across the country except in Congress. So we have to talk about ways, because the Highway Trust Fund is funded primarily from gas tax, and the federal gas tax has not been raised, and people are driving more fuel-efficient cars, which happens to be a very good thing. And electric cars. So they're not doing, I drive a hybrid car. I'm not doing my fair share, and I admit that. So we have to find a way to make sure that we can fund without, if we can't get a gas tax passed, we need to look at other ways. And Oregon is a leader in this vehicles mild travel, and look at other ways. Peter DeFazio has a barrel tax rather than a gas tax. We can even try to call it a fee, but that doesn't really work. So we have to find ways that we can keep that funding going, because the Highway Trust Fund is just, it doesn't have the dollars that we need to keep up with the infrastructure needs in our country. Welcome your ideas.
Yeah, we certainly do. The bill this time is fully paid for, which is a major accomplishment in and of itself. Big proponent. I'm impressed that we were able to get this across the finish line. And again, our colleague Peter DeFazio deserves, I think, a ton of credit for helping make sure that Oregon is well represented. Actually, the formula worked really to our advantage. It was based on the MAP 21, that little short-term two-year deal, and Oregon got a bump up in that. And then so we'll get a 5% increase and a couple of percentage points every year through the five-year span. So that should really help leverage our opportunities. But it begs the question, what about the next go-round? And, you know, the certainly, I don't care what part of infrastructure you're talking about, the needs out there far outweigh any of the funding sources we currently have. I think we're going to have to look to the states to come up with what's the new long-term funding source. Oregon's certainly doing its pilot. I'd urge Oregon to do it quicker so we can have the results, if you will, of what you're finding out as soon as possible, certainly hopefully before our five-year period is up, so that we can use that as part of a discussion point. Oregon has a great reputation, as Suzanne alluded to, being very innovative in the transportation arena. We secure grants and opportunities. Secretary of Transportation visits high above our fighting weight because of the way our communities, you guys, frankly, deliver on the projects out there. I actually think there is bipartisan support in Congress, even for a user fee like the gas tax. My Republican colleagues are of two minds on this. There's the Bill Schuster, who's head of the Transportation Committee in the House, who thinks it's a user fee. I have some very conservative Republicans I've worked with that consider the gas tax a user fee and fine with raising it. You know, it directly goes to what you're using it for. You know, doesn't go to a general fund. So I think there is bipartisan support for that. Unfortunately, the Speaker of the House is not one of those people that views it that way. We had a new Dem meeting, another business-oriented Democratic group, and we had Schuster and Ryan in when Ryan was head of the Ways and Means Committee. And Schuster was fine with the gas tax. That would be fine. You know, it's a user fee. I can sell that to my guys and my constituents back home. And like Suzanne said, I mean, everyone has broad transportation needs. But Paul was pretty adamant, nah, I can't quite see that happening, whatever. Now he's Speaker of the Bloody House, so that's going to be a bit of a lift. Although another Wisconsinite, another Republican, a friend of mine, had an interesting proposal. He went to Paul and talked about, well, what if everyone paid their fair share? And it gets to Suzanne's point on the hybrid vehicle. What if the hybrid vehicle, there was some sort of fee or way to make sure that the hybrid vehicles pay at least something? They don't have the same impact, obviously, as our gas-powered vehicles. What about the bus systems? Is there a way we could get them engaged? In other words, even bicycles, you know, is there a multimodal way of assessing different fees so that everyone in the transportation sector that hopefully benefits but also pay just a little bit? And that actually, Speaker Ryan was much more interested in. That actually had a little bit of juice. So rather than some silver bullet out there, maybe just a function of several pennies out there that add up to enough to get this thing across the finish line with a much more robust funding package for a long term.
Thank you. And I want to thank you very much for being here today. And before we express our appreciation, I also want to extend the condolences from WEA and from our audience for the loss of your stepfather.
Thank you very much.
Very sorry about that. But we also want to wish you tomorrow a very happy birthday.
So thank you.
So thank you both very much for being here. We do appreciate your views, your thoughts, the insight that you provide us. And as you know, WEA is very involved in advocacy on a lot of different issues. Transportation is a very big issue for us, and it's a big issue for our region. So we're actively working on ways that we can provide input to at the state level and at the federal level. So thank you. And again, thank you for coming and fighting the traffic to get here. We do appreciate it. So at this time, I'd like to take time out for a quick commercial break, and that is that WEA has taken a strong position against Measure 97. And we do have, in the back of the room, we have lawn signs, we have bumper stickers, and we have material back there, if any of you would like to pick that up. Randy Steinman, who is the coordinator for Measure 97 for the state, is here as well. Randy, would you please stand up? And if you have any questions, please feel free to ask him. We'd also encourage you to join that coalition. So thank you very much for being here today. There are survey cards on your table, and we take the information from those survey cards very seriously. So please take a moment and fill them out. Again, thank you to our sponsors, to Legacy Health, and to our elected officials. Thank you so much.